this is the nonsense for questions that we have. But not again, we're going to have to go through it all. There might be a late night this morning. See what happens. Someone pointed out to me, it's quite interesting, yesterday we were discussing that sutta about the monk Samiti, and he was whether the Dhamma is directly visible or whether it's the sensual pleasures that are kind of immediate and whatever in there. And he pointed out that there is a gravestone, apparently not far from here, probably the local church now or whatever in there. And it had this sign on it, talking about a baby, 1 month old, passed away here. And the point was that this also is like the Dhamma directly visible. That's a good point, It's if you look at nature, if you look at the world around us, there's always reminders of impermanence, about mortality, about all these things, almost everywhere. And one of the things that famous teachers like Ajahn Chah would almost point out, that in the world, in nature around you, if you look carefully, this signs of the Dhamma is absolutely everywhere here. And of course, that leads to, precisely these things. It leads to, if you do it in the right way, it leads to happiness and joy, and leads to the results of the practice. Anyway, so thank you for that. That was a very good point. So now let us look at the questions. Okay, gee, this is an interesting one. Okay, dear Ajahn Ramani, thank you so much. It feels like the Buddha has given us an instructional guidance manual. I think this retreat has been a bit of a wake-up call for me, and I hope to recondition myself as live the life of lasting joy. Okay, so living the life of lasting joy. Okay, great, wonderful, fingers crossed. I am complete, or I'm complex, or whatever, that's what they say, complex. Okay, good, that's great. I'm glad you have learned something, or you have kind of something has kind of clicked. That's always wonderful. This is what I have found in my own life. These things kind of gradually they click into place and you start to see the world in a different way. That's very, very good to hear that. Good. Okay. Next one. Dear Ajahn, your teaching is really very good, I have to say. Okay. Thank you. Great. Well, this is easy, isn't it? This is what I'm doing. Excellent. When you have students like this, it's wonderful to be a teacher. And a good feedback. All right. Okay. So, dear Ajahn, what is the difference between samatha and samadhi meditation? Also, during the breath meditation, would it be better to have a knowledge of Anapanasutta and understand each of the 16 steps thoroughly so that you know what is happening during the breath meditation and get a clear understanding of reality as taught by the Buddha? Yes, it is very useful to understand the Anapanasati Sutta, and that is why I will continue the detailed explanation of that tomorrow morning. So stay tuned, and tomorrow morning you get all the details of that one. Difference between samatha and samadhi meditation. Well, the Buddha never talks about samatha nor samadhi meditation. He just talks about the four foundations of mindfulness. He talks about the breath meditation. And these are all samatha, they are for the purpose of calming you, they are vipassana, they are for the purpose of seeing things according to reality, and they lead to samadhi, eventually. They lead to samadhi and also to insight. The difference between samatha and samadhi is that samatha is a process of calming down, or the result, you feel degrees of calm. Samadhi is a specific state of calm. Yeah, so when you reach a very profound state of calm and peace, and the mind unifies, and you have like a single object of consciousness or whatever, that's called samadhi. It's a specific state of calm and peace. Where samatha means calm in general, it comes in all kind of degrees and varieties. So I hope that makes sense. And so tomorrow we're going to finish off the Anapanasati Sutta. That's the plan anyway. We'll see what happens. Okay, that's the rest from yesterday, and now we can move on to today's question. So, dear Ajahn, would it be advisable to have guidance from an experienced teacher to ensure each step of your meditation is going as it should be, and you are not going astray or even mentally affected in a negative way? Thank you. Sometimes it is useful to have guidance from an experienced teacher, but a lot of the time you will find that it's not really necessary. A lot of the time all you have to do is keep on practicing and you learn so much from your own meditation experience. And, yeah, this is why I say at the end of each one, look back at what is happening during your meditation, see how it works, see how it functions, understand the perceptions that you have to give rise to, understand the process. And as you do that, you become, after a while, very skilled at looking after your own meditation. But it's very simple, really, meditation. Yeah? All you have to do is to watch the breath. Yeah? It's supposed to be simple, but actually, we tend to complicate these things. But actually, in reality, it is so simple. And the more calm and peaceful we get, the more simple it is. It's this kind of path of simplicity. We just need to abandon stuff, chuck out stuff. All the thoughts, all the unnecessary things, throw it out. And as you do that, you start to, it becomes even more simple than it was before. So it is very simple. And sometimes it is advisable to have a teacher, because sometimes, even though it is meant to be simple, that we just don't understand why we are not making progress, why we can't simplify things. What is the problem? Very often the doer gets involved, we try to control the meditation, all these kind of things, and that becomes often the problem. So we need somebody to point out this little thing sometimes. But generally speaking, most of you will be perfectly able to look after your own meditation practice. To go astray and to be mentally affected in a negative way, all you have to watch out for is that your mind stays in a relatively positive state. Yeah, you feel at ease, you feel relaxed, you feel good about yourself. If you start to kind of feel more and more confused, more and more deluded, if you start to feel angry in your meditation, that happens sometimes. If you get very strong desires arising, yeah, but especially delusion and anger, this is where you have to be careful. If that starts to happen, come out of it, don't continue. And don't think that it is good just to stay with a delusion and see what happens with it. Sometimes you go on meditation retreats, that's what this, you get told, just stay with it, kind of stay with it, until you go completely nuts. Then you have to stay in the mental hospital for 3 or 4 weeks afterwards. I was just telling one of the people, there was a saying in Sri Lanka, that one of these really kind of strict meditation centers, I think called Kandugoda or something like that. And it was a saying when I went to Sri Lanka, they told me, the Sri Lanka said to me, well, we had, saying it was 2 weeks in Kandugoda, 4 weeks in the local mental hospital afterwards. But it's actually quite easy to avoid that if you just use common sense. Common sense is that you can feel your mind going astray, you can feel that, you know it already. If you take it too far, you stop feeling it, and then you're kind of lost. But if you stop yourself in time, you know it is getting deluded, confused, all these things, come out. Do something else. Don't continue. Don't go down that path. That is the path of danger. As long as you're feeling good inside, then you are on the right track. Even if you have strange perceptions, the body doing weird things or whatever, that's kind of irrelevant. As long as you feel relaxed and at ease, and you have a sense of happiness in your meditation practice. So it is good to have some degree of meditation. If you live in the UK, you can use Venerable Chanda as your teacher. She's a very experienced meditator. So many years, sitting in meditation, it's a very positive thing. And she might be much better meditated than I am. I don't know. I'm not sure I haven't heard of that much in practice. There is access there to good meditation teachers if you really are in need. But basically, I think a lot of the time, just look after yourself, and it can go a long way just by doing that. Okay. Dear Ajahn Mamali, I find the concept of non-self hardest to include in one's daily life. Is there any tips to train into the way of thinking from childhood? In that way of thinking from childhood, as an adult, your ego is set and more difficult to let go. Thank you, Vimita. I not necessarily, as an adult, yes, you often kind of have more of an ego, perhaps, because we're kind of taught to develop the ego in life, and we think that it's a good thing to have a strong sense of self and all that kind of thing, but you can undo the damage, quite easily. It's not that hard to undo that damage. Once you start living well, you actually, these things start to kind of unpack themselves again, and you let go of that, and you start to understand, actually, life with less ego is a much more pleasant life. You feel more at peace, there's less to defend. If you have a big ego, you always have to defend that ego. to, you know, to kind of feel right about yourself or whatever. So just allow it to let go. You can do that. It doesn't matter how old you are. Yeah, you can still do those things if you really are on the right track and you practice a noble eightfold path in the right way. Just being kind to others often means letting go of a lot of ego. Because the ego says, no, you've got to defend yourself, you've got to stand up for yourself. Actually, I don't care about, you know, that. I don't care about standing up for myself, whatever. People can think what they want, I'm just going to be kind in return. Not repressing yourself, not being hard on yourself, but not worrying so much about all this ego business. So, and as you do that, and this is really what non-self, you know, to a large part is about, letting go of defending yourself, kind of just being going with the flow all the time instead of, you know, whatever, and then this it kind of just happens automatically. A large part, you know, there's so many different ways you can use the idea of non-self in daily life, and one of them is just to remember how conditioned we all are. And see that also in yourself, see how conditioned you are by the past and everything. And the more you do that, the more you can forgive yourself for your own weaknesses. It's okay to have weaknesses. It's okay to fail sometimes. It's okay to make mistakes. Yeah, and the more you see how conditioned you are, the more able you would be to forgive yourself for those mistakes. It's fine. Yeah, and then if you really make a mistake, then ask for forgiveness for the other person as well. That's also quite the nice thing to do if you want to reduce your ego. Asking someone else for forgiveness is often a reduction in one's ego when you do that. Anyway, I hope that answers your question. Let's go on to the next one. Is Ajahn Brahm a stream on here? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 words. That's the shortest question so far in this retreat then. Is this stream runner? The answer to that question is you have to judge for yourself. Yeah, that's the answer to the question. It's not something that you can, I have obviously had my own ideas about these things. Of course, I've lived with Ajahn Brahm for 24 years. I know him pretty well after 24 years. I must admit, I've always been very impressed with Ajahn Brahm's ability as a teacher, as a meditator, as so many things. But whether someone is a stream winner or not is something each one of us has to judge from our own perspective. And you will never have an absolutely certain answer. Sometimes you get people coming up to you and say, I'm a stream winner. Don't trust it. Yeah, don't trust that sort of thing. Or even worse, I'm an arahant. Don't trust those things. They are very uncertain. So trust your own judgment. You watch. You look if the person that you are with has the qualities of somebody who is a noble one. If they have those qualities, then you start to put your confidence and faith into that person. That is the right way of doing things. And then the more you see that over the long term, again and again and again, the more the confidence and the faith tends to grow. That is the way to do these things. And never to be absolutely sure whether one someone is a this or that or whatever, that's kind of irrelevant. Just look for the right qualities. Then that is the right time to put faith into somebody. Sometimes we have too much spiritual materialism. Yeah, I am a streamer. I have a certificate of stream entry. This is true. This is what happens. It's not a joke. Yeah, if you go to certain places, they give you a certificate. Yeah, okay, you had this experience. That means you're a stream entry. Okay, signed by Mark Sarasama. Wow. Okay, stream entry. Then it becomes part of your ego. You start to feel really kind of proud of that. Yeah. And after a while, you begin to realize maybe there's something kind of slightly wrong with it. So. But this is how the kind of spiritual materialism becomes so much part of the spiritual life sometimes. Okay, so I hope you're not disappointed. If I gave you that answer, I would be disappointed with myself, because that's really it's not the right thing to do, to talk about those things in that way, in my opinion. Okay. Next question. Dear Ajahn Brahmani, over the last year or so, I have started to get a blue light appearing in my mind or field of awareness as I sit with my eyes closed and watch the breath. It can ebb and flow a bit and can be a bit flickery, but sometimes it gets more steady and seems more or less to fill my entire field of perception. It is quite a beautiful color of blue. If I try to grasp it and want it to appear, then it won't. And if I try to cling onto it, when it comes up, then it can disappear. Could this be an emitter? What is a emitter? Could you say something about that? Thank you. Could be an emitter, yeah. And they all appear slightly different to different people, depending on all kinds of conditioning and things. It's possible. The way to know whether it is a real emitter or not is usually with the feeling that is associated with it. If it has very powerful, positive feelings this night, if you feel a lot of joy, a lot of peace, a lot of power in the meditation, yeah, this is a very kind of, your mind is starting to unify all these kind of things, that is usually a sign that it is a real nimitta. It's the feelings that really decide whether you're on the right track or not. That is why the Buddha always talks about feelings in the meditation, yeah, piti, sukha, pasadi, all of these kind of things. That is what really decides whether you're making progress or not. The nimitta is another sign, but you have to conjoin it with the feelings. That is when it's right. Sometimes people have a tendency, many people have very visual minds, and they create things. Yeah. And because it's create, sometimes it can be created, you have to be very careful whether it is a real nimitta or not. And it is the feelings that decide whether it is a real deal or not. So it could be a nimitta, yeah, but check out the feelings. And that is what you want to do. And as you focus on that nimitta, as you stay with it, without clinging, yeah, because as you say, if you cling, it disappears, or you hold it or whatever, as you just focus on it passively, absolutely passively, it should become brighter. Yeah, yeah? And the brighter it is, the better it is, the more easily it will take you eventually into real samadhi, into the jhanas and all these kinds of things. There comes a point. If you get this right, people have a tendency to overestimate their jhana attendance. There are so many false jhanas in this world. But if there comes a point when you feel that there's so much bliss, you can't take any more bliss, then maybe you are approaching the jhanas. Now remember, there's lots of bliss on this path before you actually get to the really deep states of samadhi. And this is what makes this path so exciting, in a sense. So try not to overestimate yourself. It's very, very common in the world. I would say 90% of jhana attainments are overestimation. Maybe it's more. I don't know. It's a lot of overestimation. Maybe 95, maybe 98%. A lot. So be very careful. It's better to be a bit humble about these things than to jump to conclusions that you have attained the jhanas. Because if you jump to conclusions, very often that will stop you from making progress. Yeah. If you think you've got the jhanas already, but you haven't got them, okay, so you will stop. You go, okay, that's good enough now. I go to Vipassana, whatever. But then you actually haven't gone deep enough. And your Vipassana will also be, your insight will also be tainted as a consequence. So be very careful with that. These things are extraordinarily profound. You're almost enlightened when you get to the jhanas. You're almost there. And I will bring this out hopefully tomorrow, if we have time tomorrow. I will make this point again as we come to the very end of the simile, the sutta of the simile of the elephant's footprint. Okay, so there you are. So I hope that helps. So just stay with that if it is the right thing. Stay with it and allow it to brighten and become more powerful. And we'll talk about this again tomorrow as well when we finish off the Anapanasati Sutta. Okay. Dhyana, towards the latter part of the deep meditation, you are supposed to get these insights of anicca, dukkha, anatta. Am I correct in saying this? Yes, you are correct in saying that. Tomorrow I will show you pretty much exactly how this works, yeah, and how to actually do that. And do these insights come up automatically on their own, or do you have to contemplate on phenomena? A bit of both. If your mind is pre-programmed to know, the mind will actually automatically go to these things because you already know that things are supposed to be impermanent, suffering, and non-self. So your mind, when the mind is very powerful, it will kind of automatically take an interest in those things. It's almost as if you don't have to do very much. But sometimes a little bit of guidance, a little bit of kind of leading the mind in the right way can also be helpful. Does that involve some sort of thinking at this stage of the meditation after watching the mind? Not necessarily. Insight is not about thinking, it's about directing your mind in the right way. So if you direct your mind in the right way so that you actually see that impermanence, yeah, it's all about looking in the right place, remembering what has happened during your practice. And as you do that, the insight will come as a consequence. don't really have to think very much, or it's a kind of very pre-verbal kind of thinking, just the direction and very limited slight movement of the mind that is required. Dear Ajahn Ramani, thank you so much for this incredibly inspiring retreat. That's good then. This is my 10th retreat with two others led by you some time ago. Really? Okay. That's wonderful. But this time I feel I got the most out of all the retreats. Perhaps it took me that long to be receptive. This is the thing, yeah, and this is what I find is that every retreat is slightly different, even if you hear exactly the same sutras. Actually, sometimes the mind is ready, and when you hear that, you kind of open up, and you feel, wow, this is now, it is really working for me. So that's good, and I think that is a very good point that you mentioned there. Yeah. So much merit to you for explaining this so carefully, and much merit to Venerable Chandan for organizing this retreat so well. Congratulations, sir. So there you are, as the future leadership by the Bhikkhuni Sangha, and we can look forward to more of that in the future, once the Bhikkhunis get really well established here in the UK. That is kind of something to look forward to as well there. And lastly, I now look forward to reading more suttas in the future. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Great, wonderful man, and marvelous, and all other positive words. Okay. So now, dear Ajahn, can you describe a Buddhist funeral, please? Thank you. Buddhist funeral. Buddhist funerals are of... it really depends what you mean by a Buddhist funeral. Do you mean the funerals that the Buddha prescribed, or you mean like traditional Buddhist funerals as they are done in Buddhist cultures? These are two different things. And if you want to go back to the time of the Buddha, he didn't really prescribe anything, any funerals. That was just part of the culture at the time. And very often they would just put the bodies out on the charnel ground, they would be burnt. Yeah, and because they were burnt, cremation has become a traditional Buddhist way of dealing with the bodies, because that's what they did at the time of the Buddha, so we still do that in the present day. So cremation is a perfectly valid way of doing Buddhist funerals, but really, a Buddhist funeral is you can do whatever you want, really. Because the idea is that when the body is dead, the body is dead. You know, like in Tibet, they have what they call a sky burial. So they just put the body out, and then the animals, the vultures, come to eat the body. It's a nice way of recycling the body, if you like it. It's a bit kind of, sounds a bit kind of, you know, I don't know, it's kind of, but in a place like Tibet, where it is so cold and the resources are so scant and it's so hard to find the, you know, to feed everyone, and the birds are perhaps hungry or whatever, it's a nice way of recycling things and reusing things. So there's different ways of doing this, and there isn't any right way of having a funeral according to Buddhism. Whatever funeral you want to do, whatever way you want to do it, you can really do it that way. So that makes it quite simple. So cremation is okay, body is dead, do whatever you like with that body. Yeah. So one thing you can do is you can put the body in the backyard, you can contemplate it as it rots up. That's another way you can do it. Yeah. This is according to the Satipatthana Sutta, contemplation of bodily disintegration. Please don't do that, because you might go to jail. Yeah. The police think, well, what is this person doing? This is some kind of... Okay, so next one. Dear Ajahn Ramani, thank you for the wonderful retreat. I am very grateful to you and Venerable Chanda for the opportunity to hear the Dhamma and practice it with you and all the beautiful people who shared their silent presence with me. Three hearts afterward. That's very nice. Three hearts for the Dhamma Sangha. That's great. One of the most joyful meditations I ever had was a death contemplation on Friday. I will use it at least twice a day in the future. I find it really helpful to start the formal sitting meditation with, because, as you said, it brings all the important things together and it gives an enormous relief. So thank you for this wonderful gift. Okay, so I would say to that use it as long as it works, but remember all of these techniques, they have like a use-by date. Yeah, they work for a while and then often they become blunt after a while. You were especially powerful when they are new to you, because when you do it at the beginning, it has a very powerful effect on the mind. But then it may, the effect will actually gradually decline. So So use it when it works, and but not be afraid of chucking it out when it stops working for you, and then do something else. That is often the right approach, so that you make sure that you continue to make progress. It was also interesting that my thoughts about dying and the actual feelings during the meditation were so different. Hopefully loads of useless concepts and thoughts will disappear from my mind about dying and death through regular contemplation. Okay, good, wonderful. Yeah. Then we have page 2. Okay. I'm also thankful because of the Dhamma talks I recognized a bad habit, inner blocks. Sometimes I was afraid to be kind with people and don't open to others who I didn't know because I felt it is better to not have any contact at all than being rejected. This was my projection. Okay? Good. Yeah, that's great. Now I see that it is still will be only their own action, and there is not too much I could do. And now I feel that I am free to feel metta anyway, no matter what their reaction will be. Wonderful, that's exactly the right way of thinking, in my opinion. That's good. My actions are mine, and I am responsible for them. And I don't have to change the goodwill towards others just because maybe they won't accept it. That's exactly right. This is a wonderful thing. Thank you, sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. I offer all the merit I could have during this retreat for the realization of the Anukampa Bhikkhuni project. I wish you all the best. Okay, that's very nice. So, great. So, very good. Okay. Devante, with heartfelt thanks, Katanyuta, please return. Okay. Yes, we shall see what happens, as I say. I can't really say anything more at the present stage. But there's always, once you go one time, there's always a reasonable chance that it will come again. You know what these things are like. Yeah. Dear Ajahn, please explain briefly how the four foundations of mindfulness fit into the suttas. Anapanasati, part of the four foundations of mindfulness. I'm a bit confused with lots of metta. Okay, so... remember the gradual training we have been looking at and the Noble Eightfold Path. Maybe let's have a look at the Noble Eightfold Path very briefly. Noble Eightfold Path, you start out with right view. Because you have right view, your purpose and goals in life become appropriate. Yeah, they become, you actually look for happiness where happiness can really be found. And part of that insight is to understand that to be found happiness, you have to live a moral life. So start living a moral life. That's the next three factors of the Noble Path: right speech, right action, right livelihood. Then you understand that the moral life also includes your mental life. You have to overcome the defilements of the mind as well. Yeah? And this is what right effort is about, overcoming the defilements of the mind. That's why I spent a lot of time talking about how to deal with anger, how to look at sensuality in a way that actually reduces our interest in that world and moves it towards spiritual matters instead. And then, once your defilements have been lowered to a reasonable level, your mindfulness is starting to arise, you are able to watch the breath because you have mindfulness, that is where Samma Sati or Satipatthana, or the you mentioned the foundations, I prefer the applications of mindfulness myself. That's where the applications of mindfulness come in. You are now able to watch the breath because you have a reasonable degree of mindfulness. That is where it all begins. Now, watching the breath actually does, one of the things that it does, it removes the very last remnants of defilements from the mind. Even though you have overcome the defilements to a very high extent, the kind of the coarse desires, the coarse ill will, all that is abandoned, there will still be a subtle residue of defilements in the mind. Yeah? And that is what is overcome by watching the breath. Gradually, 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 the defilements will fade away. And they fade away for many reasons. One of the reasons why they fade away is because the defilements can only exist as long as they are supported. Yeah, you can only have desire if you look upon the object of the desire in a kind of with with that desire, you have to see, well, this object is nice, so you look at that, and desire arises. If you keep on watching the breath, you're no longer feeling the desires or the ill will, and because of that, they decline until they are completely gone. And with the fading away of desire and ill will, the other defilements also disappear. Sometimes it takes a little bit of investigation to get to that point, and that is why the last of the Satipatthanas is about understanding the defilement, how they arise, what are the causes, how you eliminate the causes. Remember, I spoke about the Dhammanupassana before, contemplation of principles of causality. So you use a little bit of that. That's why, again, I recommend you reflect at the end of every meditation. What's going on? What happened now? Yeah, what is the sequence of steps that worked for me? I started out in this way, I had a certain attitude, yeah, and then the defilement somehow disappeared, and I, you know, what happened there? And if you look at what you were focusing on, what perceptions that you gave rise to, yeah, how you, then you start to understand how this process works and how your mind becomes peaceful as a consequence. So a little bit of insight like that is actually very useful. And these preliminary insights on the path, these are the insights that then lead to samadhi. So the purpose of the preliminary, maybe insight is the wrong word, clarity perhaps, or small insights anyway, the purpose of the insights initially are to get to samadhi. Once you have achieved samadhi, then you can have the deep insights into anicca, anatta, and dukkha. So that is the purpose of Satipatthana. It takes you to samadhi. Yeah? It eliminates the last defilements, it unifies the mind around the object, which is the breath very often, and then you gain samadhi. And then you can have the really deep insights as a consequence. Yeah. So remember, one of the ways of looking at the Noble Eightfold Path is to look at it as a path of purification. It's a purification, 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 until samadhi is attained. That's really a simple way of thinking about the whole path. Yeah, that's really all it is. That's why the Visuddhimagga is called the path of purification, but really it should be the Noble Eightfold Path, which is called the path of purification. Okay, dear Ajahn, you mentioned yesterday you conduct approximately 6 retreats per year. Could you please say where are they held and how you can apply for them? Thank you. They are held everywhere around the world because, you know, this is a thing that there is a lack of teachers around. So you get invited to many places. Next year, oh, we're going to Sri Lanka. Yeah, around this time, I go every year. I go to Singapore usually. I go to Hong Kong. I go to Malaysia. And I also give a few retreats in Perth, in our Dharma Retreat Center down there. So I think actually somebody from the Buddhist Society said that it is time that we start to post the retreats I make on the BSWA website. So if in the future, if you are interested in going halfway around the world to attend my retreats, you are of course very welcome to do so. But I would check out the BSWA website and what's going on, and then you can take it from there if you're interested. Okay. Dear Ajahn Ramani, if the mind is not sharp, concentrated, so that proper mindfulness never ever happens, is it still worth meditating? It depends what you do in your meditation. Very often you come back from work and you feel maybe tired, or you feel agitated or whatever. Sometimes just to calm yourself down, just to feel more at ease and more relaxed, that is a good enough reason to do some meditation practice. Yeah, so you can do it just for the very simple reason of feeling better about yourself. So it is really the difference between where you start and where you end up. That is what decides whether meditation is useful for you. So if you start out not so good and you end up better, that is good enough reason, because then you have achieved something through your meditation practice. If you find that the mindfulness of breathing, anapanasati, is difficult because it takes quite a lot of mindfulness to be able to do that properly, do the metta meditation instead. Yeah? And the wonderful thing about the metta meditation, if you're able to make it work, is that actually it also reduces your defilement. So it's a very powerful help in kind of propelling you forward on the path. Yeah, it helps your entire mindset to become more positive. It helps you to be more kind and virtuous in your life. And if you are able to be more kind and virtuous, I guarantee you, your mindfulness is going to, bang, come up very quickly. Yeah, so a year or two down the track, you will actually find yourself far more mindful as a consequence. So don't worry too much about if you haven't got enormous amounts of clarity. Focus on kindness. Focus on thinking in the right way. Use your meditation to help you be more calm, more relaxed, more balanced around other people. And if you use your meditation that way already, it is going to be very useful for you. Don't expect massive breakthroughs in meditation in daily life. It's very, very difficult to do that. But sometimes you get a nice meditation even in ordinary life. Like in the early morning, for example. You wake up, and if you live your life well, then you wake up clear and bright in the morning, you do some meditation practice, you set yourself up for the day, you live well, you fall asleep at night, do a bit of metta before you fall asleep, so you sleep well, wake up in the morning again, and you can continue. Get into a nice routine like that. Sometimes in life it is hard to get into those routines because you may be going through a difficult period or whatever. That's okay. Just don't worry so much about that. If you don't feel like meditating, don't do so. And then come back to it later on again. Go back on the retreat, get restarted, and get that kind of initial thing going by hearing something inspiring, hopefully. And then you kind of get back again into that rhythm later on. So don't be too fixed in your ideas, Don't be too kind of solid, it must be this way. Be flexible, see what you require, see what you need. But never, the one thing you should really hold on to always is your virtue, is your kindness, is the way you deal with people around you. That is the one thing you should never let go of. Okay, venerable sir, what is your concept of an Ishta Devata, or personal deity, or alter ego? Okay, Ishta Devata, I don't know exactly Ishta Devata, personal deity, or alter ego. Is there such a thing as a personal deity? It's interesting. Sometimes you find reference in the suttas that the devas are kind of looking down on humanity. They're sitting up there, looking down, looking out for anyone keeping the eight precepts. And when they see people keeping the eight precepts, they're so happy because they know that in the future there will be more devatas because they will be reborn. And then because they want to fight with the asuras, it means that more devatas, we can kind of fight better with the asuras. Is that real? Is that how the devas think? I'm not so sure. I think a lot of these things may be things that were taken over from the Brahmanical tradition in ancient India. This whole idea of the devas fighting with the asuras is found in the Brahmanical texts. I think it is part of the existing culture in India. I don't think it is really a very Buddhist idea, these things at all. So is there a personal deity or not? Can the deities interfere in our lives? Maybe they can, but don't rely on it. It's unreliable, it's uncertain. Will a deity really spend all this time looking after you? How often do you spend all your time looking after someone else? It just doesn't happen that way usually. So devas have better things to do than looking after you all the time. And this is part of the problems. They also have a life. otherwise, no point in being, if you haven't got a life as a devata, it's not much point in becoming a devata in the first place. So this is what it means, get a life. It means like be reborn as a devata. I would say, I cannot say categorically that devas never look after human beings, but it's not something you can rely on. It's not something that you should really take as anything significant or important for your life or for your spiritual path. And this is what we saw today in the Ratapala Sutta. The Buddha says there is no kind of abhisara there who looks after you. You are responsible. This is your life. You make sure you do what is right. Forget about those other deities and whatever. And that's really the right attitude as far as I'm concerned. Okay. Dear Ajahn Brahmali, you rock. Okay. Well, that's it. Okay, if I still believed in pedestals, you would be on one. Okay. Question, could I be on the par and still swear? I like to swear. What is this considered wrong speech? I'm a Catholic by birth and there is a dodgy joke that may answer my own question. Alert, you may not want to read this. Okay. I'll contemplate a joke later on and see if it actually it can be. Okay. Yeah, okay. So, is it okay to swear? Remember that all of these things depends on how you use swear words. And these days, people use swear words like as adjectives just to kind of make a strong statement. Yeah, that's really all they do. If you use swear words to put people down, that is when it is really bad. Yeah, if you tell someone to off, then that's obvious, that's when it is really bad, yeah? That is kind of the thing you don't want to do. But if you use them as adjectives, or use them in a way to kind of make your speech kind of more understood, I don't think it is necessarily bad. Ask yourself where you come from. I try to avoid using this kind of word because I know that it's kind of, you know, as a monk, you kind of have to be careful what you're saying. Because you know, not everybody agrees that using swear words is a good idea. So I try to be a bit careful. But if you use them in the right way, I don't think it is such a big deal personally. So just ask yourself, why are you doing it? As long as you do it, you know, without any bad intentions. You know, I'm not too fussed myself, actually, to be honest with you. Okay, no, I'm not going to read this out. This is just too much. So, okay, that's very good. I'm very glad you have the sort of confidence in that you actually allow me to read those kind of jokes. That's really that's good. Okay, dear Ajahn Mamali, it has been a wonderful retreat with full of metta and wise Dhamma reflections. I would also like to thank Venerable Chanda and the Anukampa team for organizing such a beautiful retreat. One of the best retreat I have been on. Look forward to more from the Anukampa project. Okay, so there you are. So that's good. So that's wonderful. That's very nice feedback that people are happy and content. Okay, dear Ajahn Mamali, thank you very much for this wonderful retreat. I have been inspired by your teachings and explanations of the suttas as taught by the Buddha. Also, your manner of kindness and compassion shown to us all have been inspirational, and I too would like to develop such qualities. I leave the retreat happier than I came at the start of the retreat and with clarity of the Dhamma and the simple but mysterious breath. I have learned to like my breath and will now chin out more with a breath which up to now I have not really appreciated. With much metta and gratitude. Okay, wonderful. This is very nice. This tonight is the best night, yeah? This is very nice. It's always nice when people appreciate the retreats, of course. So, anyway, dear Ajahn Mamali, this morning we looked at some of the suttas and similes on wise reflection. Do you get these insights by reading and understanding, or truly realize the reality of nature? Do you have to meditate and gain these insights through direct experience? So it is both. Yeah, these things go together. So when you read that, you know, when you read about these things, already it strikes you as true. And that very fact that it strikes you as true means you already have some degree of insight there. And because the Buddha said so, what you knew was true already becomes even more true because you read it coming from the Buddha. It kind of makes an impact on your mind. You think, yeah, I actually knew this already, but I didn't take it seriously enough. And that is the renewed insight, the renewed commitment, the renewed you know, perseverance, if you like, on the path, that it kind of sinks in deeper as a consequence. So read about these things. Continue reading the suttas. Draw on the word of the Buddha to make your practice more powerful. Contemplate the teachings. Yeah, this is what it is about. Contemplate these teachings. And as you do so, it sinks in deeper and deeper and deeper in. And eventually it leads to all kinds of insights, all kinds of profound things as a consequence. It's a gradual thing. The mind is very strongly conditioned. Our habits are very powerful. And for that reason, it takes time to change our habits and to see the world in a new way. So be patient with yourself. Have compassion for yourself. Be kind to yourself. But also seek to kind of move yourself forward on the path in the right way. So, I hope that makes sense. So, okay. Okay, thank you for sharing your depth of knowledge and understanding of the Dhamma and the beautiful results of many years of mental cultivation, which is an inspiration and privilege to behold. The Buddhist path to lasting joy feels wide open thanks to the Kalanamittas like yourself. Mega gratitude and respect. Okay, I'm very glad that you got something out of the retreat. What a wonderful thing that is. So, and if you hadn't got anything out of the retreat, I would still not be happy because I enjoy the retreat. This is kind of the thing. This is kind of the way you have a win-win situation. You don't worry too much about it. If other people are happy, it's wonderful. If they're not happy, it's still okay because I actually enjoy reading the sutras myself. So it's not such a big problem. So, great. Ajahn Ramali, Venerable Sir, thank you for the retreat. We have enjoyed the peace, relaxation, silence, our meditation, and your joyful exposition of the Dhamma in general, and the sutras in particular. We wish you good health and contentment and a happy reunion with your parents' family. We look forward to the privilege of seeing you and Sister Chanda in Sri Lanka next year. Okay, great. P.S. Remember not to call your father householder, okay? Thank you. Thank you very much for reminding me of that. There wasn't much chance I was going to do that anyway, I have to say. That probably would be one step too far. So, but thank you for your concern. Okay. Very good. Dear humans, okay? me as a human with addictions in my life, I found out I smoke because sometimes I don't like myself. But when looking inside, I ask myself, What do I wish myself? We all are wonderful humans and lovable. I start to love myself, and with every cigarette I don't smoke, I give metta to myself. So it is far more easier to not smoke. To all the people with addictions, I send metta to you. It's a chance to you. And it is a chance to grow and to find love and to your humanity. Metta to you. Okay, great. So by substituting, chucking out the cigarettes and putting in metta instead, you have kind of found that. That's wonderful. Metta is just marginally better than cigarettes. So that's great. I'm very glad that you achieved that because I would not really recommend people to smoke. Okay. Dear Ajahn, someone was asking for other monasteries that practice Buddhism in the same way you do in Perth. I was thinking to direct them to the Forest Sangha website for all the Ajahn Chah inspired Buddhism. Yes, you can go to the Forest Sangha website. That's the monasteries in the UK. You have Amravati Monastery, you have Chitras Monastery, and all of those. And they are also part of the kind of Ajahn Chah tradition. They are maybe a little bit different from the Perth Monastery in the way they teach and the way they do things. But clearly, there are many very inspiring monastics there as well. So it's really worth checking out. So check it out and see for yourself, and then take it from there. Okay. Dear Ajahn, can you please talk about the role of a teacher along the path? Thank you. Yes. One of the interesting things that you find in the suttas, and one of the things that you find, there is a very nice sutta in the Anguttara 10s at 61 called, what's it called? Avijja or something like that? And this particular sutta, it shows the causality, in an unusual way, the causality that leads to the final liberation of the path. Yeah, and it goes backward. It starts off with a kind of the liberation and insight that, and steps back then to the seven factors of awakening, the four foundations of mindfulness, or the four applications of mindfulness, the three ways of good conduct. And step by step, I'm not going to go through them all because you'll forget them anyway. And it goes back to the most root cause. What is the root cause of achieving liberation? What is the most basic thing? That's quite interesting, yeah? Because if you get the root cause right, everything else kind of happens as a consequence. What is that root cause? In other words, the root cause is to basically have the Kalyanamita, have the Buddha as your friend, to meet the noble people, to meet the Aryans. That is the root cause of everything else. Because once you have a real Kalyanamita, once you meet people who actually understand the Dhamma through personal experience, especially if it's a Buddha, especially if it is an Arahant, you get the teachings. Yeah, you actually have a chance to break through that ignorance, which otherwise, the problem with avidya and delusion is that it's self-perpetuating. There is no way out of it unless you get the teacher who comes and tells you, actually, wait a minute, there's something wrong here. And think, oh yeah, you have a point. So this is the role of a teacher on the path, is to actually help you to break out of whatever delusion that you may have, so you can actually see reality as it actually is. Otherwise, it's almost impossible to break out of delusion. Otherwise, you have to become a Buddha, basically, yeah? And that is incredibly rare in the world. So that is the role of a teacher, to help you to break out. And then, because we have a tendency to fall back into our own old habits, because we have a very powerful tendency to delusion, you have to keep on feeding those teachings, yeah, again and again and again, reading them again and again to straighten out your view. It is a gradual process to get your view straightened out. It doesn't happen straight, you know, it happens over time. So keep on reading the suttas, keep on enjoying these teachings, and as you do so, gradually this path starts to happen. And there's a very beautiful simile in this particular sutta. It's a simile of the rain on the mountaintop. Yeah, when the rain rains on the mountaintop, gradually the rain forms into little streams. And then the streams go down the side of the mountain, they go into the little lakes. The little lakes overflow into the large lakes. The large lake overflow into the large rivers. And eventually the rivers go into the ocean. And this way the ocean gets filled up. The ocean here is a simile for Nibbana, yeah? So the way to get to Nibbana is to keep on raining on that mountaintop. And that rain, what is that? Well, it is precisely seeing the noble ones, reading the word of the Buddha, hearing the suttas. That is that rain. If you keep on raining long enough, if you keep on listening to the teachings of the noble ones long enough, eventually they will form into streams, into the lakes, the large lakes, the rivers, and the ocean. Yeah, that's what happens. So keep it raining. Rain, year in, year out, until one day you actually go all the way to the end of the path itself. So that is the role of a teacher. It's pretty fundamental. Yeah, it's actually very important. And I will mention this again maybe tomorrow as the very last thing I say to you, the importance of this, because this is where ultimately you're able to have the commitment and perseverance to practice this path. Okay. Next question then. Dear Ajahn, another thank you from me for a pretty mind-blowing retreat. That means you have really understood the Buddhist teaching when you're talking about mind-blowing, because that's kind of what it comes down to sometimes. I was wondering how you learned Pali and any materials online you can recommend for learning Pali. Thank you. Yes, I can help you with that. And one of the things I don't know who has written this note, obviously, but I would not normally recommend lay people to learn Pali because your lives are already so full. And I would recommend you to spend your time more on the practice of things, because what you are going to learn from the suttas by learning Pali is not that much more than you're going to learn from reading them in English. It takes a really good understanding of Pali to be able to draw out the meaning beyond what has already been expressed by people like Venerable Bhikkhu Bodhi or Ajahn Sujata or even myself, the other translations as well. It takes a lot of understanding of Pali to be able to do that. So the commitment required is actually quite large. And as a lay person, I don't think I would commit to learning Pali myself if I were a lay person. But as a monastic, it's different because you have a little bit more time. And this, after all, is what we do. This is our life, is the suttas, all of these kind of things. So it's a different when you are a monastic. But it's not for me to tell you what to do. I'm just kind of giving you a suggestion. So if you really are keen on this, there is a nice website now called Wisdom and Wonders. Yeah, Wisdom and Wonders is the name of the website. And it has all the Pali classes that I have given at Bodhinanda Monastery actually available there. And they've been cut up into nice pieces. And I also wrote a large document many years ago which gives all the answer to the exercises of a book called A.K. Warner's book, Introduction to Pali. And there is an answer to all the exercises in there which I wrote out many years ago with translations and everything, footnoted, lots of footnotes, all that kind of stuff. So check that out, Wisdom and Wonders website, and it has teachings by Ajahn Brahm there, it has teachings by myself, and it has all this Pali class there. It's very, very nicely done. It's an English fellow called Stuart, who was kind of look after that entire website. Did a very, kind of very, very good job with it. So try that out and see if that works for you. And good. Dear Ajahn, how do we know that we are reborn? What is the evidence apart from the fact that this is what the Buddha has witnessed? Thank you. Okay, I gave a talk on rebirth at the Buddha Society of London just a few days ago, just before the retreat. And Amina over there, actually you recorded, didn't you, Amina? Was it recorded? Yeah? When is it going to be available online? Is that uncertain? Don't know? Okay, don't know. So maybe. So you can check it out because that was all about those things. I talked a little bit about the evidence there, all of that. But some people have told me it takes a long time from things are being recorded until they actually appear. That can often be a kind of bit of a lag in the gap. So, the evidence is, it's actually, I reckon there's quite a lot of evidence for these things. And I take, for me, the prime evidence, the most important one, is actually that the Buddha said something. Yeah, to me, the suttas are the real word of the Buddha. The Buddha, to me, is the greatest spiritual genius in human history. Yeah, what he says is very profound, very beautiful. He draws you along the path in the right way. If this person says there is rebirth, who am I to say that he's wrong? Yeah, to me, that kind of is what I would call anecdotal evidence. Somebody says there is rebirth, that's called anecdotal evidence. But depending on the character of that person, it can become very powerful anecdotal evidence. So because the Buddha is who he is, actually I take it incredibly seriously for that reason. So for me, that trumps everything else actually. That's the most important thing for me. But there is also a lot of other evidence. There is, I actually spoke with somebody earlier today who said that they had a past life experience, yeah? Talking about the past life, how they had been a monk in a past life. That was quite a nice conversation. I like to hear these little stories because they always, they tend to kind of confirm, well not confirm perhaps, but kind of lead in the same direction and kind of slant things in that direction. So what is the evidence? And one of the most famous pieces of evidence is the evidence done by a Canadian doctor called Dr. Ian Stevenson. He was a very, educated as a doctor at McGill University in Canada. I think it's the most prestigious university in Canada. He was obviously very intelligent, and he left at the top of his class and all this kind of thing. And somehow, because of his background, he spent his whole of his life just investigating memories of good children had of past lives. And he did this in a very formal way. He was part of the psychology department of the University of Virginia in the U.S., which is another kind of top-notch university in the U.S. And he did this research under this psychology department, or I think later on it was renamed as the Department of Perceptual Studies or something like that. And he did this over many, many years, 40 years or something. And he documented large thousands of cases of little children seemingly remembering past lives. And some of the evidence there is actually very powerful. Evidence, for example, where a child is born without any digits, any fingers, yeah? And apparently that is a very rare kind of birth defect, happens in 1 in 1 million people or something. But on top of being reborn without any fingers, the child had a past life memory of being a farmer who died in an accident when all his fingers were cut off. And this farmer, according to this child, was living in such and such a place and was, you know, this type of character. So then you can go and you can find out whether there was a farmer in that place who died in such an accident and had all his fingers chopped off. And if this kind of matches, yeah, which it did in this particular case, it's kind of astonishing because the chances of that happening at random is extremely small because it's such an incredibly rare birth defect. It is rare that people die in those kind of accidents. Yeah, so if you start to calculate the probability, it is actually very, very small. And the more evidence you have of these kind of things happening, the smaller is the probability that these things happen by accident. There's always some probability, you can never rule it out, but it is smaller. So I think that is very interesting evidence. There is many other things that you can look it up online, near-death experiences and these kind of things. One of my favorite pieces of evidence is the evidence that was written about in a book. There's a book called Irreducible Mind that was written a few years ago, and this is a book which brings out all the evidence that the mind is not limited to the physical body. Yeah, in other words, the mind is more than just the brain. It is something additional to that. And there's evidence is growing in this area. And one of the pieces of evidence that they brought out was apparently the known phenomenon in hospitals around the world that people with Alzheimer's disease, people have forgotten everything. They've forgotten their family members. They can't talk to anyone. They are completely out of it. Maybe they've been out of it for a decade or so, even more sometimes. And then at the very end of their life, just as they are about to pass away, they regain clarity. They recognize their family members. Oh, hello, son. What are you doing here? I haven't seen you for a couple of decades. Where have you been? I don't think they say that. But anyway, you know, something like that. And this is completely inexplicable from a modern medical point of view. Because if the brain is so clogged up, and the brain is really demented, it should be possible to have this lucidity towards the very end. But from a Buddhist point of view, it makes very good sense, because towards the very end, your mind is starting to detach from your physical body. It is no longer confined or constrained by the sick brain in the same way as it used to be. It is starting to detach. And as you start to detach, clarity re-emerges. Because the brain no longer filters the mind in the same way. It no longer constrains it in the same way. Oh, wow, I'm clear again. I see what's going on. And this is one reason why dementia, we often feel that dementia is such a terrible thing. But actually, it isn't really from a Buddhist point of view. It is terrible in the sense that you have to go through a lot of suffering sometimes because it is very difficult to lose your memories. But it's not terrible in the final sense, that as soon as you die, you regain all your senses again. It's not as if this is a permanent thing that kind of carries on after you die. It's not nothing to do with your mind. It's only got to do with your brain. So it's kind of a hopeful thing in a way. So this is not evidence of rebirth, but it is evidence that the mind and the physical material things are not the same thing, and that the mind is more than the physical brain. And that is the first step for being able to believe in rebirth. There has to be this separation between mind and brain to some extent. And the evidence in that area is kind of growing very rapidly. One of the great papers I read this a few years ago. This was originally published in Nature magazine. You know about Nature magazine? Nature magazine is the premier scientific journal worldwide, really. It is published here in the UK. It is the number one scientific journal. And it is reviewed by lots of people before you get a chance to publish and all these kind of things. And there was a lead article in Nature, the journal Nature, back in 2005, written by a physicist from Johns Hopkins University in the US. It's a top university in the US. And this lead article said that it is time that we face up to the fact that the world is mental. Not mental as in the world is crazy, yeah, but in the sense that the world is basically made up of mind, yeah. It is time we face up to that. Why is that? Because all of these things that we know about the world, the quantum mechanics and all of that, the world only appears if there is an observer. You need consciousness for the world to exist. And he said that we have known this for 80 years. Yeah, it's about time that we kind of take this into account. And since then, even more, you know, results in physics are just confirming that. This was in Nature magazine. Yeah, the world's premier scientific journal. What this means is that there is a shift, I think, in the world where it is getting more and more accepted that consciousness is one of the fundamental aspects of existence. The world is not just material. I think it's very obvious anyway. Who, you know, does anyone here really believe that the world is just material? Maybe you do, but that's okay. But to me, it just seems so mad. Yeah, I mean, the first thing that we know about reality is that we experience things. Yeah, I'm here. I know I experience things. Yeah, all of these things are here. And that is the first thing that we know. And the laws of nature, the way we look at the world, all that is secondary. It starts with our experience. That is the first thing that we know. How can we discount consciousness? It's you know, to me, it is just completely silly. I don't really get it at all. And I think that this will be looked back upon once we kind of get beyond this. And I think we are perhaps in the process of getting beyond it now. I think it will be looked back upon as a silly period in human history when we kind of discounted consciousness. Everything is material phenomena. We can look back. We were actually really stupid back then. Didn't we know what was going on? That's what I think. Yeah. Maybe I'm wrong, but that's what I think. Yeah. Anyway, that's a little bit of the evidence. If you are interested in this, Ajahn Sujato and myself, we did a course many years ago called Karma and Rebirth in Early Buddhism, and that is available online. I think it is available on the same website I mentioned before, Wisdom and Wonders. If you go there, we did a whole course, and we talked about some of the scientific investigation into this thing. We talked about some of the wrong myths that are available, that are out there about the karma and rebirth, all these kind of things. So maybe you find that interesting. So check that out. Wisdom and Wonders is the website, and it should all be available there. I believe, I haven't really looked at it very carefully, but I think it is available there. Okay, now, quick. Maybe time is running out, as always. Dear Ajahn, the object of my meditation has always been the breath. Each time I sit for meditation, my mind is automatically drawn to the breath. It is as if my mind knows what to do, and I just watch and see what happens. Next, a bit like on autopilot, is it okay to keep using the breath as the main object each time I sit for meditation? Would this hinder my other types of meditation, like watching body sensations? No, don't have to do body sensations at all. If you don't want to, it's completely up to you. You don't have to do those. Just keep on watching the breath. When I did the death meditation yesterday, after saying bye to my loved ones, which I found very difficult as I'm very attached to my family, my mind then was drawn to the breath. In doing so, I ended up with breath and seemed to have died happily. Okay, good. Yeah, that's what the breath does to you. It makes you die happily as well. Breath is very useful. Huh? Is that normal, Ajahn? Is it normal? I don't know. When you die, I think very often what happens is that you don't really need the breath at all. In those situations, you can just relax. Because when you die, it is becoming so clear to you that you have to let go. Yeah, it's kind of, you are faced with your death. It's kind of, you're forced to let go almost. And if you don't let go, you just suffer massively in the dying process. So I don't think you really have to use the breath when you die. You can. And if you do, you may have some good results because you're letting go with the breath. You may get the nimittas. You may even go into deep samadhi at that particular point. So it's certainly not wrong, but I don't think it is always required. So sometimes you just go straight to the nimitta because you let go so much. I would imagine at my deathbed, I am no longer in control. And only thing I have left would be my last moments with my breath. So I thought I might as well get used to this idea. Is that correct thinking? You are no longer in control then, but you are also not in control now. Yeah, this is the delusion. You think you are in control now, but you're not. It's the same thing now as it is when you die. And if you are able to let go of control now, then you're even easier for you to let go of control when you die. It's exactly the same thing. So when you watch your breath, make sure you watch it without controlling it. Just allow it to be. And the more you can kind of see it in a detached way, where you're observing it a bit like a movie or a bit like a screen, you have a distance between you and the breath. There's no sense of control. The breath is just there. And in a sense, you allow the breath to come and go. Yeah, if the breath disappears, it's okay. That means you're not controlling it. If you want the breath to always be there, then you start controlling it. So the mindfulness is natural. It is not forced. The problem with watching your breath is that your breath also disappears when you die. Yeah, so the breath is gone, and then of course you can't watch it anymore. Then it's better to maybe use something else, like a samadhi nimitta or something, to take you all the way through the dying process. It's certainly not wrong to use the breath, because the breath can be very useful, but make sure that you're not controlling too much. If the breath is always there straight away when you sit down, it could be that perhaps you are controlling a little bit too much. Yeah, that you are kind of getting into the habit of just grasping the breath straight away. The mind bang holds on to it. So just maybe try to let go a little bit and see what happens. Allow the breath just to be. Yeah, say okay. I'm not going to focus on. I'm not going to focus on the body. Yeah, feel the body instead and see what happens. And if the breath is still there in the background, that's not a problem. But try to let go a little bit and see if that helps in your meditation. It is very easy to grasp too much, and often very difficult to see that we are grasping, because it is so subtle sometimes. Okay, dear Ajahn Ramali, I would like to say a huge thank you to the staff here at the Nightingale Center, especially the serving staff who have been so kind and patient while we gesticulate wildly and which food we would like. Thank you. That's a very good point. Tomorrow you have a chance to thank them in person, yeah, because we're going to not have noble silence during the meal tomorrow, I think. It will stop around 10 o'clock. So tomorrow you have a chance in person to thank the people. We have a lunch tomorrow, right? Yeah? Yeah? Okay. So you can tell them in person how much you appreciate their kindness. So please do that. It's always nice to get good feedback, yeah? So please tell them that, and then I'm sure they will appreciate that a lot. I said to the chef today, because I go in there first with Venerable Chanda, I said to him, thank you for all the wonderful food. And afterwards he came back with this big plate of dessert afterwards. Yeah? I was wondering, is there a connection here between the thank you and the dessert he came out with? I'm not sure. That's called instant good karma, that's what I recommend. Okay, dear Ajahn Ramali, your teaching on meditation is extremely useful and practical for me. Thank you so much for this. Great, wonderful. I'm very glad to hear that. Good luck with your practice. It is already 9:30, that's usually when I stop. But there's a few questions left, because it is the last day, I'm going to go through them all. So if you wish to leave, please, as I said before, you're allowed to leave at any time. Nothing is compulsory on this particular retreat. If you want to hang around, of course, that is fine as well. Dear Ajahn, I believe monks and nuns are not allowed to earn their own living, grow foods and prepare their own meals. Why is that so? Is it still relevant today? That is right, that is precisely so. The idea is that you are dependent on the lay people's generosity to support you. And actually, it is a very nice thing to do, because when you are dependent on somebody else, you also have to give things in return. There becomes a mutual, reciprocal relationship between the lay community and the monastics. It also means that the lay people take an interest whether you behave properly. If you are completely independent of the lay community, it becomes much easier to take shortcuts with the precepts and all these kind of things. Yeah. But if you live in a mutual dependency, the lay people look at you and they say, is this a real monk or not? Or are they dodgy here? Yeah, and if you think that it is a real monk or not, well, that gives you more confidence and faith that these teachings are working properly here. So it's actually a very positive thing to have this mutual dependency between the lay people and the monastics. We keep each other in check. Yeah. We teaching and we teach each other and we support each other in a very positive way. I find it very beautiful, this kind of lifestyle. I'm always very touched at Bodhinyana Monastery. Every day we have 30, 40 people, at least, sometimes more, sometimes 100, 200 people coming just to offer us food. Yeah, every day almost. It's like almost astonishing, and it's very touching when you see that. It's a very beautiful thing. And if those people get something out of that, which I think they do, yeah, generally they seem to be happy, they're very supportive of our community, and of course we get some, certainly get something out of it. It's a wonderful, beautiful, reciprocal relationship. So I would say it's a wonderful tradition, and it works really, really well. It goes back to the time of India, even before the Buddha. And I think it is definitely still relevant today because it has worked so long. And I think it once you start changing these fundamental things, you never know exactly what's going to happen next. And often you lose out on some of the things that you didn't know, actually. You didn't really understand how important it was for Buddhism to function properly. Okay, dear Ajahn Ramali, what exactly is Nibbana? And can you attain Nibbana whilst you are living, or is it after death? Also, do you have to go through all the four, or is it eight jhanas before you attain Nibbana, or seek the ultimate truth? Thank you. Okay, so Nibbana is really, it is the main meaning of Nibbana in the suttas, is what happens when you become an arahant. Yeah, the meaning of Nibbana is extinguishment. What is it that is extinguished? Your defilements are extinguished. Suffering is extinguished. Yeah, that is what is extinguished. So, and that is what it means. So when you become an arahant, you have attained Nibbana because your defilements are extinguished. Yeah, so extinguishment, that's what it means. And then there is like, if you like, there is a kind of secondary aspect to Nibbana, and that is when the arahant dies. And you make a final end of things. But the real Nibbana is actually becoming the arahant. This is the way it is always in the suttas. At that point, it is when you attain Nibbana. After you die, okay, that kind of becomes irrelevant because you already happy the way things are here. So that is the meaning of it. You have to go through all the four jhanas? Not really. Remember that you attain Nibbana through insight, not through just through samadhi. So first of all, you have the samadhi, and the insight arises from the samadhi. And we will see how that works tomorrow by looking again at the Anapanasati Sutta. So according to the suttas, it's sufficient sometimes to attain the first jhana. Even that will do. Yeah, but the more you have, the more power you have, the more ability you have to see through things as a consequence. Okay. Venerable Sir, you may decline to answer this question. Okay, we shall see. How deep does your meditation go during these times? On the one-hour sessions in the company of about 50 others interspersed with three or four admonitions to the present in the hour. Thank you, Metta. It does not go very deep. I think that's fairly obvious. Yeah? If it went very deep, I would really be able to talk very much. So it doesn't go very deep, but it's okay. Yeah, it is. Even a little bit of peace and calm is always nice. So it doesn't matter. When you teach a retreat like this, you don't really consider yourself as taking full part in the retreat yourself. So that is kind of to be expected in a sense. So that's all I'm going to say because it's not really appropriate to say much more than I think. So, okay. Very good. Dear Ajahn, is there anywhere we can go to study Pali so that we can read the word of the Buddha directly here? Are there any courses or books? I think I've replied to that already. Thank you so much for talking through the translations and answering our questions. So again, Wisdom and Wonders website, start with that and see what happens. Dear Ajahn Ramali, please can someone remind the sheep about noble silences. So, sheep, yeah? Is that everyone here, or is it somewhere? which sheep are you talking about? I'm not sure about. So we have one more day, yeah? One more night, one more morning, and so please keep the noble silence to the end. It's always nice to kind of, sometimes the last few hours of a retreat, you know, it would be very nice. So keep it all the way to the end, and then see what happens. So, okay. It's really good. So sheep, let the sheep be quiet. Venerable sir, your reflection on death contemplation, I notice that I still seem to identify myself with my mind. Unfortunately, I have not yet reached the samadhi stage of meditation yet. Please advise on any other practice to help me overcome this specific delusion. Thank you, Vimetta. It is very natural that you should identify with your mind. Yeah, this is one of the most profound things to overcome, your attachment to your mind. So what you do is just gradually overcome that. You gradually let go of these things. You identify less and less with the content of your mind, less and less with your thinking mind. You identify less and less with your, you know, there's a nice little sutta in the Anguttara 3 called the Goldsmith Sutta, or something like that, or is that not the, whatever, no, it's something else. The Pachadogna, whatever, it's number about 100 in the Anguttara 3. And it talks about the gradual refinement of the mind as being similar to the gradual refinement of gold. And in there, it kind of you abandon defilements gradually, and the very most subtle defilements there are defilements that have to do with your family, your nationality, and your reputation. Yeah. So, in a sense, these are the things that we attach to in a very deep way. Who we are, what we identify as. So, after a while, we start dropping those things as well. As you become very peaceful and quiet in the meditation, you don't stop identifying so much with these kind of things. And it's actually very nice when you do that, because it leads to less kind of... When we don't identify so much with these things, it means that everybody really becomes much more equal to us, less discrimination and all of these kind of things as well. So gradually you overcome those things. Who cares if we're born in Sri Lanka or born in Norway or born in anywhere? It's kind of completely irrelevant. We're all human beings. We all have basically the same desires in life, the same defilements that we're trying to overcome. Our aspirations are the same. Yeah. That is what matters. Different genders, who cares about different genders? Path is still the same. Who cares about different age, different disabilities, different all of these things? All of that, you eliminate that. And after a while, you just feel like you are a being. You're a human being. That's all you are. Don't really compare yourself to anyone. It's a very nice mental state. That's what it very large part, what it means to drop the mental content, drop the identity thing. That you just feel like you are a human being. You don't need to compare yourself to anyone else. You neither compare nor do you not compare. You just exist. And then you end existence afterwards. So that is what happens. So just take it gradually and slowly, become more peaceful, and see how that gradually your sense of self actually disappears as you become peaceful. Dear Ajahn, my meditations are often peaceful, but also a bit dull. What are the means of arising joy and happiness in the meditation here? So, what you have to do is you have to perceive the present moment in the right way. Yeah? So you have to kind of feel and inspire yourself a little bit. And one of the most powerful things that the Buddha always says is precisely these things that they call sila nusati and chaka nusati. Just the knowledge that you live well. And then you feel, wow, I live well. I live a good life. And then you feel happy about yourself because you know that you live a good life. It's not an ego trip, but it's just a quiet knowledge inside of yourself that you know that you live well. That already gives you happiness. Yeah, it gives you a sense of joy. Yeah, it kind of lifts you up a little bit. So the more you practice your sila in ordinary life, the more kind you are, the easier it is to access this feeling good about yourself in this way. This is one way of doing it. Another way of doing it is to contemplate the Buddha, as I talked about at the very beginning, understanding that you have this extraordinarily amazing teacher who shows you the path to the end of all suffering and the highest happiness. Who would have thought that even such a person existed? there is a teacher in this world that teaches us the path to the highest happiness, for goodness sake. Isn't that kind of mind-blowing? That's really mind-blowing, isn't it? And once you kind of get that, you get this feeling that you have this extraordinary teacher with this extraordinary insight into the human predicament, what is suffering, what is happiness, all these kind of things. It's like, wow, this is actually true. I've got this teacher, the Buddha. And you start to feel a sense of joy because you understand that you have a path out of the problems in life. You have a path to experience the highest happiness. And just that is already very powerful, very beautiful. So there's different ways of inspiring yourself. And just being here on this retreat, being surrounded by other good people, feeling the atmosphere a little bit, tuning into the good qualities, doing a bit of metta meditation because that gives rise to happiness. There's many different ways of doing this, but you try to find your own little way as you do this. And then once the joy arises, you're quite right, joy usually brings mindfulness, and mindfulness brings ability to meditate properly. Dear Ajahn Mahavali, thank you so much for your teachings. Is yesterday's death meditation available online or anywhere else? I believe it will be online, yeah, so it will be. Yeah, Anukampa website, it will be available there. So, okay. Dear Ajahn, is there such a thing as the middle path road for lay people? I have probably had the false belief that the Buddha spoke of this. Not really. The middle path is also for lay people. Yeah, the middle path is the Eightfold Path, and everybody really practices the Eightfold Path. But the way it manifests is slightly different. So you live a celibate life as a monastic, and in lay life, most people don't live a celibate life, and that is. It's just a different degree, if you like, of practicing the path. That's really all it is. But the general idea is exactly the same. And all the things that we have been talking about on this retreat, they are the middle path. Okay. So, we are coming to the end of the questions, if you like. Dear Ajahn Mahavali, each time you sit and meditate, does your mind become automatically purified? Or do your defilements too gradually lessen? Or is it only by wise reflection you can achieve this? Thank you. It is both. Yeah, it is each time you sit down, there should be some degree of purification. Each sitting should kind of, if you feel more relaxed, more at ease, more clear after the meditation than when you started, it means there has been some degree of purification going on during the meditation practice. So measure yourself after your meditation compared to before, and if you see an improvement, you know that your defilements are declining. The defilements also decline over time, gradually. Yeah, so if you live well, generally speaking, from one year to the next one, you find that your defilements have declined. So both is right. Wise reflection. Yes, wise reflection also works. If you reflect wisely, that also leads to the elimination of the defilements. And that is kind of the point of things like the death contemplations and these things. If you contemplate those in the right way, you have less desire and craving as a consequence. So all of these things are really meant to overcome defilements, to make you peaceful, to make you relax, and to enable you to follow the breath and do meditation as a consequence. Dear Ajahn Mahavali, could you give us some advice on maintaining our mindfulness levels after this retreat? That is impossible. You will not be able to maintain mindfulness after this retreat. Yes, that's true. It's actually true. So, what you should aim for in your life? Yeah, I was going to talk about this tomorrow, but I can talk about it a little bit now. What you should aim for is to have enough mindfulness to know that you live well. That is sufficient. You will not be able to maintain a mindfulness after a retreat because the circumstances here are special. It's impossible to have this kind of mindfulness in daily life. If you try, you're going to get very disappointed. You're going to be frustrated. You're going to use willpower and force, and you're going to feel much worse for it. So forget about it. Then you go straight away, the whole idea. Chuck it out the window. Instead, what you should do is you should try to have enough mindfulness in your daily life to be able to live well, to be able to do the right kind of actions, the right kind of speech, and if on top of that you're also able to watch your mind a little bit as well, so you don't get too angry and this kind of things. If you're able to do that on top of it, then it's absolutely wonderful. And then gradually, by doing that, you will be able to create a more positive mindset inside of yourself. You come back on the retreat next year, your mindfulness will come back. It will come back with a vengeance, because you will be on retreat and you will be having living in the right way in between. Your mindfulness will be more powerful next year. So it's really on retreat that you can expect your mindfulness to improve, not so much in daily life. Okay, Vinobhadra Ramali, I just want to express my deep gratitude to you for the Dhamma Dana. This is my second retreat. First was a 3-day session and was like dipping my toe into the water. I have gained so much insight into my own mind and quite intrigued on studying the suttas in detail. This retreat was like taking a long swim in a serene pond, drinking the water, cooling myself and developing metta. You made me see that there is such beauty around and inside the pond. Great! Much better to you, and may you find the end of suffering. Much, much better. Okay, that's very, very nice, and it's wonderful. So may you also have success in your practice. So all you have to do now, and this is the hard part, that is to keep on being committed and persevering in the practice. That's what you have to do. And as you do so, you will reap more and more benefits as you carry on the path. Okay. Dear Ajahn, during this retreat, I am experiencing an absence of feelings, both positive and negative, and I am really enjoying the break from them. Okay. However, I know that when I will be back in the work world, they will come back like a big wave. My main problem is doubt. I cannot make decisions easily, and I always think, what if? Could you please give me some advice on how to overcome doubt in my daily life? Thank you. You are an emerging teacher. Okay, in a minute. Thank you for giving us the light. Okay, good. How to overcome doubt. So there's different kinds of doubt. One is the doubt that you have on the Buddhist path. Yeah, how should you practice? How should you live? And that doubt is overcome usually by studying the suttas and becoming familiar with Buddhism, and then also looking at your meditation practice and seeing, understanding your mind, understanding what are the wholesome qualities, what are the unwholesome ones. Yeah, so this is a very important part of overcoming doubt on the spiritual path. And this is a doubt we talk about when we talk about the five hindrances. To overcome doubt in your ordinary life, well, what you are talking about here is really decision making, how to make decisions. And there are some very basic principles to use to make decisions. And one of them is that often you can just procrastinate. You don't have to make decisions straight away. Sometimes people think that you want to have to make decisions straight away. Often it's better to procrastinate. Wait until it is absolutely necessary, then make your decisions. But this is the first thing. Don't allow yourself to be pressured unless you feel ready to make decisions. Yeah, so it's okay to have some degree of doubt. The second principle of decision making is make decisions when your mind is clear. Yeah, don't make decisions if you feel that you have some ill will in your mind, you have strong desires, you are restless or agitated, or you have sloth and torpor, all these kind of things. Wait till you have settled down and you feel at ease and you feel relaxed. You have a degree of clarity. You're not being biased by your defilement so much. And when your mind is in that state, then usually you can trust your decisions. They don't have to be logical. Sometimes you feel what is right. And very often, it is perfectly okay to go with your feelings or your intuition. You just have to know when your intuition is reliable and when it's not reliable. Your intuition is going to be reliable when there is no defilements in the mind. It's going to be incredibly unreliable if you're full of defilements. Yeah? So go with that. in the end, even if you want to make a rational decision, very often there is a degree of intuition there anyway. Feelings are always part of any kind of decision making, whether you want to or not. That is the first thing. Have the right kind of mind state when you make a decision. The second way of making a decision is to ask yourself, what do you want to get out of this decision? What is the purpose? And remember that from a Buddhist point of view, if you want to advance in your Buddhist practice, what matters is that you make a choice that helps you in your practice. And this is what the Buddha talks about all the time. He says that, how do you make a decision whether you're going to stay in this monastery or that monastery? How do you make a decision whether you have Ajahn Brahm as your teacher or someone else as your teacher? How do you make a decision whether you wear this robe or another kind of robe? Simple little things. And the answer is, the way to make all of these decisions is to make a decision where you know that you will improve in your mental qualities. That robe which makes you improve in your mental qualities is the robe you should use. The robe which makes you improve or increase in your bad qualities is the robe you should not use. So wherever you know that this will lead to an increase in good qualities and a decline in bad qualities, that is a choice you should make from a Buddhist point of view. So the worldly choices don't matter so much. What matters is how the outcome of those things affect your spiritual life. That is what is important in Buddhism. So don't worry so much about those worldly choices. Just go eeny, meeny, miny, mo, and then just choose either one. That's good enough. As long as they are on the right side of leading forwards on the spiritual path. So how should I choose a robe, for example? How do I know what robe is suitable? Now, if I kind of go to the robe shop in Thailand, they have robe shops, and I look in the window, I say, wow, that robe is really nice. And I develop a lot of craving for that robe, I probably shouldn't be having that robe. This is how you decide these things. If I think, oh, I would like a nice robe like this and that, probably that robe is the right one for me. But if I think, that robe is good enough, I will be happy with that, that is the right kind of robe. Same thing with everything in life, really. If you're going to choose a new job, or are you going to stay with your present one, which job is going to make you give you most opportunities to go on retreat when you want to? Which one is going to lead you to not having too much pressure so that you always kind of feel you get angry easily because the pressure is so high and these kind of things? Which job makes it easier for you to lead the spiritual life in a nice and peaceful way? Relationships, same thing, Find someone who is reasonably compatible with you, someone who kind of thinks a bit like you, who also believes in kindness and morality. Don't choose some scallywag who has completely different ideas from you. This matters. This is why the monastic life works, because we have largely with like-minded people who also try to live a life of kindness and compassion. So this is how you make choices. In the last final analysis, this is Ajahn Brahm's way of making choices, and you probably heard it before. You take a coin, heads you choose A, tails you choose B. You flip the coin lands in your hand, you cover it up, and then you look B, and you think, oh no, not B. Okay, then you know it should do A. That's how you do it. So you're not actually flipping the coin to decide, but you're using the coin trick to see your emotional reaction to the outcome, and then you know what you have to do then. If you know it too much already, it won't actually work, but sometimes it can actually be helpful now. So there you are. Remember that most choices don't really matter so much. Most choices in life are kind of irrelevant. It is what you make out of them afterwards that really matter. So if you make something good out of whatever choice you make, then it will work out nicely. That is the most important thing. The choices themselves, often they're pretty neutral. Okay, I have good news. This is the last question for tonight. It is not even a question, I think. Let's see what is it. Dear Ajahn Brahmani, I found the meditation on death very illuminating and expansive. Is there an audio version online or any further advice on how to continue this practice? Many thanks and metta. The audio version will come up on the Anukampa website at some point. So that is the audio version right there. Is there any further advice on how to continue this practice? Maybe there is. I'm not aware of it. This is just my version of the death contemplation, and there are probably many, many other ways of doing this. And some of you may find those other ways even more powerful. It's hard to know. We all live a bit different. Really, it comes down to reflecting on death. Yeah? In the morning, when you wake up, remind yourself that today you could die. And if you could die today, what does that mean in how you live your day-to-day? I heard there was one man I knew from Brisbane in Australia, and he thought like this every day when he woke up. Before he went to work, he thought, I could die today. What does that mean? It means I have to leave my wife and kids in a good way, because I don't want to end my, you know, last thing I do is have an argument and then kind of go off in a huff to work afterwards. That's terrible. I don't want to die like that. So he reminded him every day that I'm going to leave my house in a good way. Remember, you can't really afford to have an argument with anyone, because you could die at any time. Yeah. Do you want to die after having an argument? If not, then the only way to do that is to make sure you never have an argument with anybody. Yeah. If you feel like you're about to enter an argument with someone, just withdraw. Go for a walk, you know, go somewhere else. Hide in the toilet or something like that. Until you kind of cool down again, yeah, and then you come out again afterwards. Know that there is no, we have no time to do bad things in this life. There is no, you know, everything we do matters. Every little thing will either advance us on the path or subtract from the path that we're practicing. Every little thing is important. There is no time to have arguments. There's no time for ill will. There's no time for these negative emotions. And once you get that, once you understand that, and this is what the death contemplation helps you to understand, that, yeah, it makes the present moment so important, because the present moment is what really is what matters. Now you can do something. Now is the chance to live in the right way. Never think that it's okay to get angry one time. Yeah, it isn't like that. It is never useful to get angry. If you can avoid it completely, not by suppression, but by wise reflection, what a wonderful thing that is. Anyway, that is a long session for you, and that is all the questions, which I'm very, very pleased with that. So we have been able to answer everything. Well, of course, we haven't answered everything, but we have answered those things that were in the box. There's endless things to be answered, unfortunately, but that's just mine. So, and that is all for now. So please have again a nice night's rest, and continue for a few more hours. And then tomorrow we'll have the last talk again tomorrow morning. So we'll see you again tomorrow morning. Let's just pay, for those of you who wish, pay respect to the Buddha Dhamma Sangha before we leave.